And good afternoon to all our young scholars throughout the state of California. This is Philosophy 120, Critical Reasoning. I've got rented lips today, I guess. Anyway, welcome to our course. We're coming to you from the California State University Dominguez Hills campus and the DHTV television studios, and hope everybody's having a great Thursday. Things are starting to wind down, and we're almost to the end of our course. I think we've got a couple of other sessions. Of course, we're taking a break for the Thanksgiving Day. We won't convene on Thursday. But as far as today, we've got some announcements to make. I need to discuss what happened last week. And we've got some videos to watch, some opportunities for some participation points and things of that sort. We're finishing up chapter five, and with that we'll segue into the announcements. If you noticed on your Blackboard announcement screen, there is the update that the chapter five quiz is now available. You'll also receive an email about that. And it's the 8th of November, that's a Wednesday evening. You have until midnight. So that gives you almost a couple of weeks to complete that. Did I say November? Yeah, I guess it's a little further out than that. I think it's maybe the 18th or something like that. 23rd, maybe. You know, why don't we go to the, why don't we go to the computer and I will pull up the announcements on the page. And let me just get organized and get in the groove here, and then we can do that. Let's see. It's black on your side. I don't know what's going on. They're looking in the booth, and there were some problems that we had earlier with the computer screen, so we may need to reboot that. Maybe we could talk about that during the break. But let me just at least read it since we're not able to get it to you. It is midnight, Wednesday, November 23rd. That's the deadline for completing Chapter 5 quiz. So we want to prepare you for that. And in order to do that, we're going to first do some sample problems from Chapter 5.2. And then we will get into the couple of other videos that we have from Chapter 5.2. Then we're going to go into 5.3 problems because we already looked at the five rules for categorical syllogisms during the last broadcast. We'll do the problems for 5.3 and some videos for 5.3, and then we're done. Then you'll be ready for the quiz for Chapter 5. If we have enough time at the end of the segment, we might just barely get into Chapter 6 and show you the operators for propositional logic and talk a little bit about that. Let me now discuss what happened last week. We had some technical difficulties with the slate. Didn't have any of the worksheets available. None of them copied over from the previous semester. They were actually deteriorated. There was something wrong with them, so they'd either been copied over or something else. We didn't have a backup either. Today we have a backup, so the slate's still not working. We'll take a look at that, but at least we have the overhead camera, and we'll jump to that in just a few moments. Let's see if there's anything else that I need to mention. We did talk about the rebroadcast. There is a deadline for the midterm exam. That's November 17th, midnight. That's Thursday, a week from today. And I believe that that is about it. Tonight, Thursday, is the homework for points for Chapter 4 is due. And so with that, I believe that is about everything. Did I say that the midterm exam? Yeah, I believe everything is pretty much covered. Of course, if I've made some statements of fact inaccurately, I'll rely on you to either text in or to call in and set me straight on that. I don't happen to have a copy of the syllabus in front of me. But if we have the overhead camera available, I would like to segue into some of the problems for section 5.2. There we go, that looks really good. And let's go on ahead and see what we've got going on here. This is for section 5.2, problems one, Roman numeral one, problems 5, 6, 12, 17 on these page numbers. And then we've also got in Roman numeral two, wanted you to take a look at problems 2, 5, 8, and 9. That's on page 255. And then there's some additional exercises that I'd like to get to as well. So most of our program for today, young scholars, is going to be devoted to completing chapter 5, going through these concepts and making sure that you understand them by way of applying them to some of these problems. So the instructions read that we're supposed to use a Venn diagram to determine whether the following standard form categorical syllogisms are either unconditionally valid or valid only from the Aristotelian standpoint or invalid, then what we want to do is identify the mood and the figure. You know that once you combine the mood and the figure together, that gives you the form. And then cross-check the answers of the list of the valid syllogism that's in the back of the book or on page 262. You remember page 262 has also that table of the 15 unconditionally valid and then the conditionally valid 9 forms. So this first problem reads as follows. It reads, no concertos are symphonies, is the major premise. The minor premise is no symphonies are string quartets. And the conclusion, here's our conclusion indicator, no string quartets are concertos. Why don't we go on ahead and symbolize this? This would be a no C, R, S, right? And then no S are string quartets. Let's do SQ. And then our conclusion, no string quartets are concertos, are C. Let's double check for standard form. Our eyes immediately go to the conclusion and its predicate. This C stands for concertos. Here it is up here. This is the major premise that contains the major term. Good, it's in its right location. It's not down here. Minor term, minor premise. This is in standard form. That's very good. So our major term we said was concertos, or you could just put the abbreviation if you wanted. The minor term is string quartets. Middle term is this S term right here, which stands for symphonies. Let's do the distribution on this. These are E-type propositions, so subject and predicate are all distributed. That's done. What are you getting for the mood on this? What is the mood? We've got an EEE, it looks like. The mood is simply the letters that signify the categorical propositions in the premises and the conclusion. What's the figure? Well, you know, I like to determine the figure by putting a hash line through the middle term. The middle term is this S term here, the term that's repeated twice in both premises, and that positive sloping line corresponds with a figure 4. So I put a 4 there. So the form of this, combining the mood and the figure, is an EEE4. And if we were to go to the list of conditionally valid forms, and we were going to go over here to a figure 4, it does not appear on there in either the conditionally valid or the unconditionally. So it appears to be invalid. This argument appears to be invalid. But we want to double check it by using the Venn diagram method. As I said, from here on out, for the duration of our solving these categorical syllogisms, testing them for validity, we're also going to use this visual confirmation method of the Venn diagram. It's a very intuitive tool, and it's a good second visualization, and works really well. So we've already got it set up. Let's label it here. You know, the major term comes over here. It's from the conclusion. These are the two circles for the conclusion. So we've got SQ on this side, and C comes over to this one. The middle term comes up here at the top, which is S. And one thing that I like to do is to pull these off to the side. If we were to tackle this major premise first, no C or S, we're dealing with these two right here. So I pull these circles off to the side because this other circle can be a little bit of a confusion for me. This is the C, this is the S, and E proposition is shaded right there, which would correspond with all of this area right here. So step one is done. Let's go to the other side over here. This is the S, and this is SQ. No S, no members of S are members of SQ. That E proposition is shaded right there, which corresponds with this area here. You remember our rule. We go from the premises to the diagram, and then from the diagram to the conclusion. In other words, once we've done our markings or shadings from the premises onto the diagram, we stop. We make no marks for the conclusion. We simply look and see if this diagram supports the conclusion. So does what we've done here support this conclusion? Is the conclusion represented by these two circles? Is this an E proposition? No, we've got this blank area here. If it was shaded in, it would correspond. But in going from the premises to the diagram and the diagram to the conclusion, this diagram does not conform to this conclusion. It confirms that this is an invalid argument. It would be valid if the premises allowed this to be shaded in here. Let's take a look at this next one here. All compounds that destroy the ozone layer are environmental hazards. All chlorofluorocarbons are compounds that destroy the ozone layer. Therefore, all chlorofluorocarbons are environmental hazards. All compounds that destroy the ozone layer are EH. How's that? All CH, chlorofluorocarbons, are compounds that destroy. There's our C term. Thus, all chlorofluorocarbons are environmental hazards. Let's check for standard form. EH is up in the top, good. CH is there in the middle one. This is standard form. Major term is environmental hazards. The minor term is chlorofluorocarbons. And the middle term is this compounds that destroy the ozone layer. Distribution on an A-type proposition, only the subject term is distributed, right? Good. What's the mood? What are you getting? Is this an AAA? Right. All of these are universal affirmatives. The figure, what are you getting? A negative sloping line through the two middle terms is a figure one. So the form is an AAA1. This AAA1 is usually called the Barbara syllogism, since the word Barbara has three A's in it. Rumor is that Aristotle's girlfriend was named Barbara. Just kidding. Aristotle didn't have a girlfriend by the name of Barbara. So let's double check over here. And here's in first spot under figure one, AAA1. So this looks to be a valid syllogism. Somebody's making a valid argument having to do with compounds that destroy the ozone layer, environmental hazards, and chlorofluorocarbons. Let's take the two terms off of our conclusion here and use them to label our Venn diagram. And up here, we do universals first, but both of these are universals. It doesn't matter. The reason we do universals first is that involves shading. And once we do the universals, then we do the markings later, because we don't want to mark over a shaded area. We don't want our shading to go over a marked area. Let's take this first one that has to do with C and EH over to the side over here. All members of C are now members of EH. So that's going to correspond to everything coming up to this arc, right? So all C are now members of EH. And on this side over here, all CH are C. All CH are C. That means all of these members of CH down here in this portion, all of these are emptied out. There's only one place they can go, and that's right in this area here, which is still within this C, group of C, these members of C. So now the question is, since we've gone from the premises to the diagram, does this diagram support this conclusion? Well, the conclusion is going to look something like this. All CH are EH, right? So has there been markings right up to this arc of EH? And yes, what we've done with both premises, we see some of our shading going in this direction, some of it going this. The combination of both has shaded over the appropriate area to support that conclusion. So we have visually established that this is a valid argument. A form of an argument AAA1 is always valid, and the Venn diagram will also support its validity. Let's go on to our next problem. All supernovas are objects that emit massive amounts of energy. Are objects. All quasars are objects that emit massive amounts of energy. Therefore, all quasars are supernovas. Looks like an AAA, right? But I don't think it's a one, so we're gonna have to investigate this. Here's the major term up here in the major premise, that's good. Minor term in the minor premise, we're in standard form. Major term, supernovas. Middle term, excuse me, the minor term is this Q term, quasars, right? And O is the objects that emit massive amounts of energy. Distribution, the subject term of each, since they're A-type propositions, the universal affirmative. What's the mood? We said it's an AAA. And what's the figure? When the middle term is in the predicate of both premises, that is what, a two or a three figure? That's right, it's a two figure. So the form of this argument is an AAA2. Let's come over here. There's an AEE. No AAA though, and same thing with the conditionally valid. So this appears to be an invalid argument. Let's double check over here and see if we come up with the same thing. All S are O and all Q are O. Notice that for all Q to be S, we would have had to go on up to this arc. We have this huge blank area here. Because this does not support the conclusion, because the Venn diagram does not support the conclusion, it substantiates that it is an invalid argument. Using this diagrammatic Venn diagram method, we've established the same thing. So it's a good double check. Let's see what we have here next. All survivalists are persons who enjoy simulated war games. No persons who enjoy simulated war games are soldiers who have tasted the agony of real war. Therefore, all soldiers who have tasted the agony of real war are what? We don't have it here. Well, what should the major term be? If this is the middle term, isn't that the major term right there? Yes, it is. They are survivalists. That's the major term. Soldiers is the minor term. This middle term, P, right? Persons who enjoy simulated war games. What's the distribution? A gets distributed there. E distributed here. A right there. Distribution is done. What are you getting for the mood on this? What's the mood of this syllogism? An AEA, right? What's the figure? This is a positive sloping line through the two middle terms, which equates to a figure one. So the form is an AEA1. Let's take a look at our list here. There's an EAE, but there's no AEA. So this appears to be an invalid argument. Someone who's making an argument about survivalists and persons who enjoy simulated war games and soldiers who've tasted the agony of real war, they appear not to be knowing what they're talking about. This is the subject term of the conclusion. The predicate term of the conclusion goes in the bottom right, and the middle term goes up here. These are all universals in the premises, so it doesn't matter where we start. All members of S are members of P, so they've all been pushed out into here. and no PR soldiers. That's going to be this area right in here, right? In order for this conclusion to be supported, the conclusion is all soldiers are S, it would have to look like this. We've got just a portion of it. We don't have all of this area is not shaded in. So this confirms that it is an invalid argument. Good. 5.2, problems. Use Venn diagrams to obtain the conclusion that is validly implied by each of the following set of premises. If no conclusion can be validly drawn, write no conclusion. Young scholars, imagine how this might be helpful for you. You might have two premises in an argument that you're trying to put together for one of your papers. You might have a debate coming up and you've got your evidence, but you don't know how to draw a valid conclusion. Well, this section of exercises will help you create or design a valid conclusion. So let's take a look at this first example here. We've got two premises, some P are not M, and some M are S. Well, the middle term appears to be this M term, which would make this major premise, which contains the major term, where does that go? That goes here in the predicate, right? And the minor term appears to be S. This is the middle term, M the middle term, so S has got to be the minor term. It's got to go here in the subject of the conclusion. We said that the middle term is M. Well, now we have to decide if this O-type proposition and this I-type proposition, and look at the figure here. Let's see, the distribution is going to be over here, and on an I there is no distribution. So the mood is an OI something. We don't know what we're going to make this yet for it to be a valid argument yet. We need to look at that. But we're going to say that this has to be, based upon the location of these middle terms, it has to be a 1. So we're looking for a figure 1 that starts with an OI. And here, I'm sorry, this is going to be a figure 4, isn't it? This is a positive sloping line. So it's a 4, an OI4, and I don't see that we have one, nor in the conditionally valid. We cannot make a valid argument out of a form OI anything. There's just none that appear on here. So there is no possible conclusion. No conclusion is possible. So we won't even go over to this. You see the method though? Let's try the next one and hopefully we will arrive at a conclusion. This is the exact same one. Got a duplicate there for some reason. Some PRM, that's an I proposition, right? And this is an A proposition. Looks like the middle term, M, is there. So here's the major term that goes in the predicate. Here's the S term that goes in the subject, major term P, minor term S, middle term M, and the distribution is going to be right here. The mood is an I, A, question mark, and the figure is a 4 again. Let's see if there's anything. Yeah, take a look at this. There's an I, A, I, figure 4. That means the conclusion has to be what? The conclusion has to be an I-type proposition. If it's an I-type proposition, then this will be a valid argument based upon the list of unconditionally valid forms. For this to be an I-type proposition, what does the quantifier have to be, young scholars? Some. And the copula? Right. So this is an I-A-I and a figure 4. And that is a valid argument. Let's come over here and verify that it is by using the Venn diagram method. S, P, M. We're going to start with the shading first, the universals first, all MRS. Every member of M is a member of S. And now we go to the particulars. Here's the particular affirmative, some PRM. Some PRM. The only place, as we've got the shading over here, to place it is right there. So the conclusion is an I proposition, some SRP, if it has an X in the middle from what we've done with the two premises, it will be valid. That is the result of what we did here in the premises. We've gone from the premises to the diagram to the conclusion. This does support that conclusion, so it is a valid argument. See, and we've now determined, just by looking at this, these premises, what would be the valid conclusion. That's the prop. That's the purpose of this exercise. Take a look at this next problem. No PRM, some MRS. This is an E proposition. This is what? An I proposition. What is the major term? It's up here in the major premise. The minor term, here in the minor premise. The middle term, distribution, only in the E proposition. What's the mood? It's an EI something. What do we think? An EI4? Yes. Is there an EI something that would make it valid unconditionally? Yeah, an EIO, that's the last entry here on the table of valid syllogistic forms. Well, if we make the conclusion an O-type proposition, we'll have a valid argument. So we know that our major term has got to come over here, which is P. Our minor term has got to be in the subject of the conclusion. And for it to be an O-type proposition, the quantifier has to be what, young scholars? And the copula has to be for an O-type proposition, are not, right? So that is supposed to be valid. An EIO4 is valid. Let's double check using the Venn diagram method over here. Subject of the conclusion, predicate of the conclusion, middle term. We start with the universals first. We'll take the E proposition, which is no PRM. No PRM, that's this area in the middle, which would correspond with all of that. And then we do next the particulars, some MRS. Some MRS. Right in the middle, right? An I proposition, very good. We've gone from the premises to the diagram, now from the diagram to the conclusion. And it looks like we've got an X in the S area, and that would make this Venn diagram accurately representing this O-type proposition. Since you recall that for an O proposition, the X is anywhere in the S area, and it's over here, still in the S area. This is a valid argument, and we've just established it by using the Venn diagram method as well. Folks, we're coming up on almost a half an hour. I think there might be a few other things that we could do that might maybe we've done sufficient amount. Some happy cows are great cheese-making animals. All happy cows are cows from California. Well, I think we've seen that commercial, have we not? Well, why don't we do this, folks? Let's go on ahead and finish up some of the videos that we started with at the broadcast. We didn't get a chance to finish them all. And then we will analyze the video. We will translate what we believe is the thrust of the argument. And then we'll subject it to our tools and see if it's a valid argument or not. Wes Anderson, if he's a great director, hopefully you are learning to appreciate some of his movies. One of the early ones was Rushmore with young Jason Schwartzman. And he is a 15-year-old that has just this huge crush on the kindergarten teacher at Rushmore, his private school that he goes to. And Miss Fisher, Olivia Williams, has to set him straight. So let's take a look at the library relationship discussion from the video or the movie called Rushmore. And let's go ahead and turn to that, and then I can restart the computer and see if it works. Okay, here we go. Here's Rushmore. Take a look at this.
Crossed my mind that you might consider that a possibility, yeah?
Quite apart from the fact that you're a student.
I'm not trying to pressure you into anything, Miss Cross. But I'm surprised you brought it up so bluntly.
I just want to make sure.
We've become friends, haven't we?
Yes.
Good. And, the truth is, neither one of us have the slightest idea where this relationship is going. We can't predict the future.
We don't have a relationship, Max.
But we're friends.
Yes, and that's all we're going to be.
That's all I meant by relationship. You want me to grab a dictionary?
No, I just want to make sure that we understand each other.
I understand. You're not attracted to me. C'est la vie.
Max, you're 15 years old. Attraction doesn't enter into it.
If you say so. Look, all I'm getting at is that...
Sorry about that. I had to restart the computer. Oh, catching me a little off guard. Okay, so let's take a look at the overhead. We have captured some of the dialogue here that we will translate. Olivia says, or Miss Cross says, and I did restart the computer for those of you in the booth there. And maybe during the next video, I'll see if we can log into that or not. Okay, has it ever occurred to you that you are far too young for me? Saying basically far too young for a relationship. Quite apart from the fact that you are a student. Max's response, or she continues to say, Max, you're 15 years old. Attraction doesn't enter into it. So I've got a conclusion and a premise, and I need another premise in there probably. So some 15-year-olds are not people with whom I have relations. Notice how this could easily also be all, but maybe there are some 15-year-olds that she's willing to have at least some kind of a relation. I don't know. But I've used the word some here, so this is an O proposition. All 15-year-olds are people who are far too young for me. Therefore, some people who are far too young for me are not people with whom I will have relations. So there is the structure of, I think, what might be an acceptable type of translation put into a syllogistic form for what she's trying to get across. And here it is now in an abbreviated form using some of our symbols. Some 15-year-olds are not PR, right? People with whom I will have relations. All 15-year-olds are people far too young for me. And some people far too young for me are not people with whom I will have relations. So the major term here is this PR. And the minor term is this people too young. And let's see if we're in standard form. Here's the PR term. There it is up there. Here is the PTF term. Here it is in the minor premise. So we're in standard form. The middle term appears to be these 15 years old, and that's in the subject of both of these premises. So that's going to be 15 year old. And what's the mood here? What's this? This is an O, this is an A, and this is what? Another O, O-A-O. And what's the figure on this? That's a 3, is it not? So the form is an O-A-O-3. Here's an O-A-O-3, figure 3, O-A-O. It's in the list of unconditionally valid forms. So it appears to be valid. She's making a valid argument to him. Let's double check over here using the Venn diagram method. The subject of the conclusion, the predicate of the conclusion, and the middle term. We start with the universals first, that's the A. All 15-year-olds are PTF, right? So that's going to be everything up to here. All 15-year-olds are now moved in this area. And then this major premise up here, some are not PR, some 15-year-olds are not. And let's see, all 15-year-olds are P, yeah, okay, that was right. And then some 15-year-olds are not, so I guess it's gonna go right here. Is that the only other place it could go? Some 15-year-olds, well, let's take a look at this. It's gotta be up in this area here, right? If this is the 15 and this is the PR, at least one member of PTF, excuse me, at least one member of 15 is not a member of PR, so it would be over in this area here. Well, the only place that's left is this area right over here, is that right? Can you visualize that, young scholars? The only left area that's unshaded, that's still above this arc right here, still above the arc, is over here. The question before us now is, does that properly represent some PTF are not? There's at least one that's not a member of PR. And this O-type proposition is the right way to diagram this Venn diagram. And does that correspond with this? Yes, it does. So we've gone again from the premises to the diagram, and we've asked ourselves now, does this diagram properly represent that conclusion? And it does, so it is valid. Very good. Well, folks, next we want to take a look at a dramatic film from, you know, I guess I didn't do the pay it forward handout. I guess we're going to have to move forward to Fast Times at Ridgemont High instead. So to the folks in the booth there, while you queue up Fast Times at Ridgemont High, apparently I didn't get a copy of that in my handouts or in my worksheets. This is, 1982, Cameron Crowe's coming-of-age film about a school out in the valley. I'm not recommending it, just a few things in there that are rather funny. One is, if you're a Sean Penn fan, which I happen to be, this is one of his earliest movies, and he plays Jeff Spicoli, a surfer guy, and he has a chance to take out for a cruise the star high school football player's nice Camaro, or Firebird, one or the other. And he's got young Jefferson's brother in there, and of course he crashes the car. Well, his claim is, after he crashes the car, that he can fix it because his father is a television repairman with an awesome set of tools. But when you see the condition of the car, the very remote chance that he's going to be able to fix it. So let's take a look at the clip from Fast Times at Ridgemont High. And it's the younger brother who makes the claim, he's going to kill us. So watch this.
Car. You said he was out of town.
And he is.
All right. gonna kill us. He's gonna kill you and he's gonna kill me. He's gonna kill us.
Hey, man, just be glad I had fast reflexes.
My brother's gonna sh**.
Make up your mind, dude. Is he gonna sh**? Kill us.
Fight is gonna sh**. Then he's gonna kill us.
Relax. Alright? My old man is a television repairman. Got this ultimate set of tools. I can fix it.
You can't fix this car, Smacaulay.
I can fix it.
Fix it. Okay, so here we've got some of the dialogue, and if we go to the overhead camera, you can take a look at that with me. It reads, after Spicoli wrecks football player Charles Jefferson's car, Spicoli says, "Don't worry, I can fix it." Jefferson's brother disagrees. Spicoli claims that his father's a television repairman with an awesome set of tools, thus he says, "I can fix it." Well, here's the translation. If we take a look at the overhead camera with me, it says, some people who have TV repairman dads are people like me. All people like me are people who can fix cars. Thus, some people who can fix cars are people who have TV repairman dads. So we've got what looks to be like an IAI possibly. And on the next page, we have abbreviated it, put it into our syllogistic form. And we've got our Venn diagram nearby, so we can test that way too. Let's first check for standard form here. And people with television repairman dads, abbreviated is up here in the major premise, that's good. People who can fix cars here in the minor term and the minor premise, so we're good. So here's the major term, minor term, and here is the middle term, right? That way I don't have to write all this out. What's the mood? What are you getting on this? An I, A, and this is also an I, right? And with this type of an arrangement, a positive sloping line, that reflects what kind of a figure, young scholars? Are you believing that's a four also? So we're looking for an IAI four form of an argument. And here we've got it right up here, an IAI four. So it appears that Sean Penn is coming up with a valid argument. Let's verify it here against the Venn diagram, PTVRD and PLM for the middle term. And let's do this universal here. All PLM are fixed cars. So this is going to be like this. And next we go to the particular, we do that marking second. Some of this are members of that, which is going to put the X right here, right? We're looking for an I-type proposition between these two. That's what this major premise is. So we've gone from the premises to the diagram. Now we ask, does the diagram support the conclusion? The conclusion is an I-type proposition, so we need to have an X in the middle, which we do, from what we've done with the premises. So this is valid due to the list. This is valid due to the Venn diagram. And so Sean Penn has done a pretty good job of making a valid argument. The next one is Quiz Show. And this is Robert Redford's movie that is cast by, let's see, who all's in there? Ralph Fiennes is in there. And Morrow, I think, is the other guy that I'm looking for. And he's a super genius. We can come back to me now. We're done with this on the worksheet. We'll do another worksheet after this next video. But in Quiz Show, he's discovered that he has taken money on this quiz show just like all of the other contestants. And he now is trotted out in front of a congressional hearing where he finally makes a statement and confesses his guilt that he was fed the answers ahead of time and he misrepresented himself, basically lied to the American people, all for this money that he was being given or that he was winning on this rigged television show. So here is a quiz show, and let's take a look at Ralph Fiennes here and making a statement before a congressional hearing. Watch this.
I lied to the American people. I lied about what I knew, and then I lied about what I did not know. In a sense, I was like a child who refuses to admit a fact in the hope that it'll go away. Of course, it did not go away. I was scared. Scared to death. I had no solid position, no basis to stand on for myself. There was one way out, and that was simply to tell the truth. It may sound trite to you, but I've found myself again after a number of years. I've been acting a role, maybe all my life, of thinking I've done more, accomplished more, produced more than I have. I've had all the breaks. I have stood on the shoulders of life, and I've never gotten down into the dirt to build, to erect a foundation of my own. I've flown too high on borrowed wings. Everything came too easy. And that is why I am here today.
Mr. Van Doren, I want to compliment you for that statement.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Van Doren, I would like to join the chairman in commending you for the soul-searching fortitude displayed in your statement.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Mr. Van Doren, I just want to add my kudos. I have listened to many witnesses in both civil and criminal matters, and yours is the most soul-searching confession I think I've heard in a long time.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Van Doren, I'm also from New York, a different part of New York. I'm happy that you made the statement, but I cannot agree with most of my colleagues. See, I don't think an adult of your intelligence ought to be commended for simply at long last telling the truth.
Right. Did you see the last senator and the point that he was trying to make? That's what we want to focus on here. And I've transcribed the dialogue. So if we go to the overhead camera, you can take a look with me on what he said. That's what we're going to try and translate and assess the validity behind what he's saying. The senator says, I'm happy that you've made the statement, but I cannot agree with most of my colleagues. I don't think an adult of your intelligence ought to be commended for simply and long last telling the truth. So if you go to the overhead, take a look with me here at the way that I have translated that statement. People identical to you are intelligent people. That's an A-type proposition. I should have had the word all there, right? My apologies. Here's the quantifier, no, so this is an E proposition. No intelligent people are people who should be commended for telling the truth. Finally, no people who should be commended for telling the truth are people identical to you. So we've got a translation of what he's trying to get across, and we've got it symbolized here on the next page. All P are IP. And that's people identical to you are intelligent people. And no intelligent people are people who should be commended for telling the truth. And no people who should be commended for telling the truth are P, people identical to you. So here's the major term up in the major premise, the minor term in the minor premise. So we look like we're in standard form. And the middle term here, getting lots of fours, right, is IP. The mood is an A, what, EE? Is that what you're getting to? AEE, right, with the quantifier no. That's an E-type proposition. And the figure here, again, seems to be, what, a number four? So the form of the argument appears to be an AEE with a figure four. That's the form in AEE four. And it appears to be valid, right? That's the first entry here on the list of unconditionally valid forms here at the far right-hand side. So we're going to mark this as valid, but we're going to do a double check using the Venn diagram. We're going to label this from the conclusion. The subject goes over here, PCTT, and over here P for the predicate of the conclusion, the middle term IP here at the top. These are both universals, so it doesn't matter which one we start with. Let's go on ahead and use this one off to the right, the major premise, all IP are P. So every member of P is now a member of IP. All P are IP, which means it's going to be shaded just like that. Hopefully that's similar to what you got, right? Let me move that over a little bit more so you can see it. And then this E proposition in the minor premise, we'll pull the Venn diagram circles off to the side for that. Here's the IP, here's the PCTT, and this is an E-type proposition, which should be shaded like that. This then, from this minor premise, translates over into this diagram as shading all of this area. So we've gone from the premises to the diagram. Now we go from the diagram to the conclusion. This is an E-type proposition. Both of these should be shaded in the middle. And look, in fact, they are. An E proposition for the conclusion would be shaded in the middle. The results of what we did, the two premises, did cover in the correct area for this E-type proposition. We have established that it too is valid. Well, folks, what I think I want to do is take a break. And when we, actually, if it's okay with the folks in the booth, can we run the Jimmy Kimmel question of the day so we can get some participation points? That way, while we're on a break, the students can muddle over this and see if they want to craft their response while we're away at the break. So the question of the day, if we could put that on the lower third, thank you so much, is making your children cry unnecessarily cruel and unusual, or is it funny? Well, we just had Halloween not too long ago, and probably for the sixth or the seventh year, late night television host Jimmy Kimmel has told moms and dads across the United States to tell their kids the following morning when they come asking for their candy to say, "I stayed up and ate it all," and to videotape or record on your phone their responses. Well, many of the kids have got some horrific things to say. Others just cry and flop on the ground. And so we want to take a look at a video from a season past. I don't know when it was, but it's a timely because of the time of the year to watch this. So take a look at Jimmy Kimmel and his video and answer the question of the day, which is it cruel and unusual punishment, or is it funny? Here's Jimmy Kimmel. Watch this. And then we'll go straight into break after this, if that's okay. See you soon, folks.
It's time now for our beloved holiday tradition. Hey, Jimmy Kimmel, I told my kids I ate all their Halloween candy.
Last night, we ate all your candy.
Why?
Because it was good.
You ruined my life!
Yeah, we ate it all while you were sleeping.
Oh man, I'm gonna eat it all. I'm gonna eat it all. Jimmy Kimmel said I should eat all your candy. Okay? Okay, I'm gonna eat it all. Yeah, I'm gonna eat it. Okay, this is funny. Well, let's see. Jimmy Kimmel said I should eat this too. Okay. Okay, I got it.
All of it?
All of it.
Every single bite?
Yeah.
You must have a bellyache.
I got hungry last night.
Eat an apple!
mean I ate all of your candy.
Those aren't real drawers, buddy.
Get out.
We ate all the candy.
We'll get some more next time.
I ate all your candy.
That's okay.
Please talk to me for the rest of my life. I need to eat something else!
What was wrong? Hey!
Stop playing! Shut up! I'm laughing!
I was just joking. Okay?
We'll still shut up and go on the other
Excuse
room.
Me!
I told you not to!
Are you mad at me?
The whole entire bag?
Yeah, I'm but sorry.
It's okay. It's fine.
It's fine? Like, there's none left.
It's fine.
Kids, I got something to tell you.
What?
Mommy and Daddy ate all your Halloween candy last
night. Well, you get quite a variety of responses, right? So, folks, why don't we go ahead and take our break, and you can text in or email in your responses. Is making your children cry unnecessarily cruel and unusual, or is it actually funny? So give me an argument for which you believe. Give us some reasons to believe why you think it's either cruel or unusual, or give us an argument why you think it's funny. And we'll see you in 5 minutes. Let's go in and take a break, and then we'll track your responses. See you in 5 minutes, folks.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Obi Wogboy, and I'm currently a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason I came to this school was for the great environment, the small class sizes, and the amazing sociology program.
Many of our brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing, and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The suit is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man's able to be clean, they feel good. It gives this confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin and Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it the results are better academics, more social, a better social life. And a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes and my home life. I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and it was like, nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know.
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
All right, and we're back. Sorry about our computer problems here, folks, but we will take care of that and be able to take a look at our website probably by the next time we convene. But nonetheless, please stay up on those announcements and make sure that you double check those things. And the question of the day is making your children cry, or is it unnecessarily cruel and unusual, or is it funny? And so thank you for the responses that are starting to come in. Thank you also for the reminder that I got an email or two of people asking me to go through a particular problem. And without the slate running and the computer on the fritz and not having it set up on a blank piece of paper, I'm sorry I don't have that, but I will do that at the next meeting. Stephen, thank you for a video, and we'll take a look at that. Thank you for your email. Well, Philip has got the first response. Philip, thank you so much for responding today. And he says, I think if it happened in my family, I would know it was a joke because we've always pulled April Fool's jokes on each other. But in families with very young children who don't understand or use jokes, I think it would be cruel. I would also wouldn't like it if parents did that to me and put it on TV for everyone to see. Yeah, especially when you get older, around the time you're in your teens and you discover the world of YouTube and you see it out there, I think that's going to make for some pretty dysfunctional family relationships. I agree with you, Philip. Good reasoning. Thank you. And Joshua is next. Joshua, thank you so much for your response. Appreciate it. Watching kids cry is funny, says Joshua, when you know that their crying is for nothing and it was all a joke. Okay, I'm just trying to see how that's in an argument form. Why is it funny? Because you know that it's for nothing, that they're crying for nothing. Okay, yeah, maybe so. Joshua, thank you. Christian reads as follows. I thought some of the reactions of the kids were funny, but most of them were appalling. At least there was some kids that had no problem with it. Yeah, I really enjoyed some of those that said that it wasn't a problem. Christian, you chose both, and I'd asked for an argument for one or the other, but maybe you didn't catch that part. Not a problem. Christian, thank you nonetheless for your response. That's good. Mark, thank you for your response today too, Mark. Making children cry on purpose can be cruel because if they are very young, they won't understand why you just made them cry, and they will think that you're just being mean. That's pretty good. It is cruel, but also a little funny, which is why people do it. yeah, it is unfortunately a little bit funny when you know that the joke's on somebody else. But we've become kind of a spectator culture, have we not? We do kind of resonate with people's misfortune, and that's a part of our education, I think. Thank you for that, Mark. I appreciate it. Stefan, thank you for your response also today. Stefan's reads as follows. I believe that making children cry intentionally is both cruel, but a need. Okay. What I mean is that parents make kids cry because it teaches youngies that life won't be fair and we could have to get used to it. Ah, interesting angle. Watching kids cry of laughter would be the whole intention of the video. Okay, yeah. Stefan, thank you so much for that response, and thank you to all of the folks that chose to respond. If there's others that trickle in, if we have time, I'll go ahead and read them. What we want to do is segue into our set of videos for chapter 5.3. You know, 5.3 is the section that had to do with the infraction of various rules. In order for a categorical syllogism to be valid, you know, it's dependent upon a particular form, an arrangement of the terms in a particular place with a certain mood, and also the middle term in a particular location that will end up making the form of the argument, and those forms, particular forms, are valid. There's many others that are not, though. The purpose of section 5.3 is to identify what the problem is and to name the fallacy committed. It's either one of five rules that are broken. So the exercises in this next set of videos include everything that we've done so far, but looking for those that are invalid so that we can name the fallacy. When you come upon a categorical syllogism and you've established that it is not on the list of conditionally or unconditionally valid syllogistic forms, and then secondly, after you confirm its invalidity by looking at the Venn diagram method, then the next thing you do is go to section 5.3 and identify why it's invalid. Of course, if you have a valid argument and you've confirmed its validity by the Venn diagram, you can avoid section 5.3 altogether. 5.3 is only when you run across an invalid argument. You start with rule one. Did it break rule one? No. Then it'll go to rule two. Did it break rule two? No. You keep going on until you find the reason for its invalidity. So the next one that we want to take a look at is called Face-to-Face, and it is from the movie called Heat. This is Michael Mann's 1995 crime drama with Al Pacino and Robert De Niro. Al Pacino is a police officer, and he is face to face now with a guy who takes down the scores. He is a thief, a high level thief, taking pretty pricey things. And before he catches him in the act of stealing something, he's going to let him know what he's going to do. So let's take a look at Heat, face to face, and then see if we can find the argument in there, translate it, and test its validity. Take a look at this, folks.
You know, we're sitting here, you and I like a couple of regular fellas. I mean, you do what you do, I do what I gotta do. And now that we've been face to face, if I'm there and I gotta put you away, I won't like it. But I'll tell you, if it's between you and some poor bastard whose wife you're gonna turn into a widow, brother, you are going down.
There's a flip side to that coin. What if you do got me boxed in? And I gotta put you down. Because no matter what, you will not get my way. We've been face to face, yeah. But I will not hesitate. Not for a second.
Maybe that's the way it'll be. Or, who knows?
Or maybe we'll never see each other again.
Right, so we've got our overhead camera hopefully set up and ready to take a look at the instructions for what we're doing next in our next segment here. We're going to translate ordinary statements into categorical syllogisms, then identify the mood, figure, and form to test its validity, then using a Venn diagram to double check its validity or invalidity. If invalid, we will investigate the broken rule, name it, name the fallacy, and then move on. So Al Pacino, his argument here is, if I'm there and I have to put you away, I won't like it. But I'll tell you, if it's between you and some poor bleep whose wife you're going to turn into a widow, then brother, you are going down. In other words, you're not going to live, is what he's saying. And so Pacino's argument, put into a syllogistic form, is probably something like this. All times when you're going down are times I won't like. He said, you know, I wouldn't be happy with it. No times I won't like are times between you and someone else dying. No times between you and someone else dying are times when you are going down. So Pacino's argument we need to symbolize. And we've got something like this here. And let's make sure we are in standard form. The major term here, TL, are times I won't like, right? And that's up here in the major premise. And here we've got times between you and someone else, TBYSE. And the middle term is right here, the TWL. So we are in standard form, so it's going to work. This is the distribution here and here. Here and here, and mood is going to be what? An A. What are you getting? AEE. And what's the figure on this? That positive sloping line appears to be a 4, so the form is an AEE 4. Do we have an AEE 4? Yeah, it looks like we do. So this is going to be a valid argument, actually. Yeah. Well, I don't think I would like that. Why don't we do this? Why don't we change all times between you and someone else dying, or times when you're going down, and then why don't we change this to an A proposition and make it an AEA 4, just so that we know that we've got an invalid argument, AEA, just for the purposes of demonstration. So it's not on the list of valid syllogistic forms. We've made it intentionally invalid by making sure it's not on the list. Let's double check its invalidity by using the Venn diagram. And let's go over here to this first one, all TL. R-T-W-L. See how we've gone right up to the arc there? And then over here, no T-L-W. And then if this is now all T-B-Y, that means that this has to be shaded. We're missing all this area, so it is invalid. Well, let's go to the rules, okay? Rule one says that the middle term has to be distributed at least once. And you see that it is. T-W-L is distributed at least once. So rule one isn't broken. Rule two is if a term is distributed in the conclusion, then it has to be distributed in a premise. And it is distributed here, right? And this one here, though, well, yeah, it's distributed there and it's distributed. So rule two is okay. Well, let's go to rule three. Two negative premises are not allowed. Well, it didn't break rule three because it's got an affirmative and a negative. Let's go to rule four. Rule four reads, a negative premise requires a negative conclusion, and a negative conclusion requires a negative premise. And so it looks like what we've done is we have drawn an affirmative conclusion. We've made an affirmative conclusion from a negative premise. So it's rule four that has been broken. And what we would say is that the fallacy is drawing an affirmative conclusion from a negative premise. Rule four, with that explanation, drawing an affirmative conclusion from a negative premise. Let's see if we can squeeze in one more video. And what's next is Wayne's World. This is the Saturday Night Live early duo of Mike Myers, pre-Austin Powers days, along with Dana Carvey. And this is their spinoff from one of their skits that they did on SNL for many years called Wayne's World. So here is the first movie, Wayne's World, and he's gotten a birthday gift from a girlfriend that he separated from and is trying at all costs to avoid. So let's take a look at Wayne's World, the gun rack gift. Watch this.
Okay. What is it?
Gun rack.
A gun rack? A gun rack. Yeah, right. I don't even own a gun, let alone many guns that would necessitate an entire rack. What am I gonna do with a gun rack?
You don't like it? Fine. You know, Wayne, if you're not careful, you're gonna lose me.
I lost you 2 months ago. Are you mental? We broke up. Get the net.
Get the net. We've already broken up. So here's the syllogistic form that I put it in. Take a look at the overhead camera. Some gun racks are things for people with guns. Some things for people with guns are things for birthday boys or birthday people, or birthdays we could even say, making that plural if we wanted. Some things for birthday people are gun racks. Well, here we go over here. Some GR are PG. Some PG are BP, and some BP are GR. So let's see, this is gonna be the major term, minor term, right? Middle term, looks like it's gonna be that right there, the PG. The mood is what, an I? And the figure is a four, an III four. And that is not on our list here. And so we know that it's invalid. Let's go on ahead and label our Venn diagram. And this I proposition is gonna be over here, right? And also over here. And the conclusion here is supposed to be in this area, and it's not, so it's automatically invalid. But what's the rule? Rule one, see, there's no distribution for any of these I-type propositions. And so the fallacy is the very first rule, that the middle term has to be distributed at least once. In an I proposition, there is no distribution. So undistributed middle is the reason for its invalidity. Undistributed middle. We could abbreviate that. I think we're doing okay on time. Let's go to Notting Hill. Can we do that? And then I'll read the remaining responses that we got. This is Julia Roberts, along with Hugh Grant, 1999. And in this segment, he's telling his friends that she's come into the store and that she says she's just a girl and that she loves him. And he said, no, maybe he's made the wrong decision. Let's take a look at the video clip for Notting Hill, and then we'll come back and do the problem here. Can we go ahead and segue over to Notting Hill? The wrong decision? Here we go.
Yeah, good move. I mean, when all's said and done, she's nothing special. I saw her taking her trousers down, and I definitely glimpsed some cellulite down there. Good decision, yeah. All actresses are as mad as snakes.
Tones, what do you reckon?
Never met her, never want to.
Brilliant. Max?
Absolutely. Never trust a vegetarian.
Great. Thanks. Brilliant.
I was called and I came, what's up?
William's just turned down Anna Scott.
You daft prick.
No, it's actually quite sensible. That painting isn't the original, is it?
I think it might be, yeah.
But she said she wanted to go out with you.
Yeah. Well, that's nice.
What? Well, you know, anyone saying they want to go out with you is pretty great, isn't it?
It was sort of sweet, actually. I mean, I know she's an actress and all that, so she can deliver a line, but she said she might be as famous as it can be, but also that she was just a girl standing in front of a boy, asking him to love her. Sod a dog, I've made the wrong decision, haven't I? Max, how fast is your car?
Spike's gesture says it all, right? Okay, so sometimes with actresses are times girls say, I love you. And I chose some because saying that all times with actresses are times that they say, I love you, that's not the thrust of what they're saying, and you can't really say all times that actresses say that. Maybe all times that girls say I love you are nice times. That seemed to be reasonable. And since he's talking down about actresses so much, no nice times are times with actresses. Maybe this is what he was originally thinking, that they could always deliver a line. You never really know what they're saying, if it's actually truthful or not. And one of the one of his friends there at the restaurant said, bunch of snakes, right? So translating that into a categorical syllogism, the abbreviated form, we've got some TA, times with the actresses are times girls say I love you. All times girls say I love you are NT, nice times. No nice times are times with actresses. Is this in standard form? We've got our major term here, major term, good, minor term. So TA is going to be the major term, times with actresses. The minor term, NT, nice times. And this TG for the middle term, right, are, times girls say I love you. The mood appears to be an IAE, right? IAE. And what's the figure? A 4? An IAE 4. And if we look that up on here, there is not an IAE 4. So this is clearly invalid. So hearing that, I think what we want to do is taking accounting of our time. We don't have much more time. I'll leave it to you to do the Venn diagram and also to find out which rule has been broken. And then we can review that when we get back together. Folks, we don't have much time left. Let me encourage you to review the announcements and make sure that you meet those deadlines for the remaining assignments that have to be done. Chapter 5 has been put up, the quiz, and I believe you've been sufficiently armed to take that. There are some additional problems, however, we will do next time we convene. Those are the problems for homework that were assigned, not for points, but we can go over those together at the next broadcast, and then we'll also get into Chapter 6, and then talk about your research paper and the final exam. If the folks in the booth can email me the responses that were sent in, then I can make sure that the folks get the appropriate credit, and thank you for that. And folks, I will see you next Thursday. Everybody have a great end of the week and a great weekend. Take care now. Bye-bye.